Hallelujah. Yes, Lord, we want more of you. Lord, we worship you this morning. Jesus, you are the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, God Almighty manifested in the flesh, the one who died on the cross for our sins and rose from the dead, and there is no other way to salvation. There's no other way to eternal life. There's no other way for forgiveness of sins but through you. And Lord, we just exalt you today. We thank you today. Lord, I pray right now in Jesus' name that you will move in this place, that you will move upon this message today as we continue to delve into this end time delusion, this end time deception that is upon us. Lord, I pray that the church, the body of Christ, be warned, that even the wicked be warned. Your word is coming to pass, and we must get ready for all these things to come to pass. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hey, you can be seated this morning. Everything going all right? We good? All right. Good to have everybody here this morning. Well, it's time for part two. And there's going to be part three because there's no way I can do this. Oh, I was up again till 3 o'clock in the morning doing this one, after working on it all week. So there's a lot of stuff. It's more than just making slides. It's the reading and research and digging, and then one thing leads to something else and another thing, and then Chad keeps sending me stuff, and I'm just like, oh, man, all right. So let's put up the scripture first here. We're going to put a scripture up before we get into the PowerPoint slides, which I have scriptures in the PowerPoint slides too, but I think it was important to put this one up this morning. Ephesians 6:12 here. Everybody ought to know this one by heart, but we tend to forget, don't we? He said, "For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, and against spiritual wickedness in high places." Somebody say high places. Some translations say heavenly places. You know, that's the word shamayim, right? If we went in Hebrew, it'd be shamayim. Well, that means in the skies. Now, isn't Satan known as the prince and power of the air? Don't we get that from Ephesians chapter 2? Right? I don't know why people think that the devil and demons are in hell. No, they're up here. They're with us. And they set up strongholds in the air over areas, and they operate in the air. Is that any wonder that we're seeing strange things in the skies? Should that surprise us? It really shouldn't surprise us. The devil can manifest himself as an angel of light. In fact, the angels are actually called, God said when he created his angels, they're angels that he said are just his ministering spirits, are flames of fire. All right, and you're going to see some of that. But you need to remember, and all Christians need to remember, that the battle is always with the unseen realm, the demons, the fallen angels, Satan. Those things are real. I don't know why anybody, to tell you the truth, anybody would fall for this extraterrestrial alien lie, this deception, because all Satan and his demons are doing is putting on different garments. They're just putting on a different identity. But they say the same things. What's interesting is when they speak to these mediums, they always say that Jesus was one of them, or that Jesus was just one of the great teachers, one of the great avatars, right? That he's not God Almighty, the Creator. And they actually try to take his place as the new messengers and the new saviors and the new God. And folks, we just need to wake up to this. Many people, you sit here and think, oh, this is silly, some of you. But it's not silly to a lot of people. A lot of people are into this. And a lot of Christians are. And just wait till next week. I'm going to have so much fun with dealing with the Vatican and NASA. And I was going to try to get to that this week, but then it kind of like, nah, I got to slow down and go back through. And really, even though I covered a little bit of the spiritual side of this last week, we need to delve deeper into it. So I guess we can start. Let me see if I turn my clicker on here. There we go. All right. So the Great End Time Delusion, Part 2. Y'all ready? We got a lot to do here. All right, we're going to go back over a little bit. Remember last week, and this is for those that didn't see last week yet, but we'll have to go back and watch it. But Zechariah 5, 1 and 2 here, we'll read this first. It says, "Then I turned and lifted up my eyes and looked, and behold, a flying roll. And he said unto me, What seest thou? And I answered, I see a flying roll, and the length thereof is 20 cubits, and the breadth thereof is 10 cubits. So 20 cubits, let's see, what is that? That's about 30 feet by about 20 or so. And when he said he saw a flying roll, if you look it up in the Hebrew, it means a scroll. So basically a flying roll-like thing or cylinder. Now, of course, I get attacked from people all the time. And we haven't heard from Carl the Calvinist in a while. He calls himself the High Calvinist now. Carl the High Calvinist means he's highly deceived. But what he tried to say when I was dealing with this right here is, oh, that's just a scroll of the scriptures. That's not some kind of flying thing. And I thought, I've never seen a Bible 30 feet by 20 feet. Have you? No, I haven't. Nor do I see Bibles flying around in the air. Nor do I ever see Bibles called the curse. So I'm sorry, Carl, but you're wrong again. All right. He even said that the strong delusion was our belief in free will. Yeah, this is how deceived poor Carl is. But I hope he wakes up before he ends up in hell. Zechariah 5, 3 through 4, "Then said he unto me," speaking of that flying scroll, that flying roll, he said, "This is the curse." Somebody say, "This is the curse." Is the Bible a curse? No, the Bible's a blessing. The Bible is the truth. The Bible is the inspired, infallible Word of God. The Bible is the only solid truth we have in this world. Amen? It's a gift from God to have His holy Word in writing. But He said that this flying scroll is going to be in the air. This flying cylinders, He said, are going to be the curse that goes forth into over the face of the whole earth. And then he talks about it's going to consume those who are wicked, who are in sin. And we're going to talk more about that probably next week, about it moving into houses and this whole abduction thing. And what's going to, I believe, how the Antichrist is going to monitor everyone. It's not just AI, folks. It's going to be spiritual. And if you don't serve and bow your knee to the Antichrist and to the beast system, then they're going to mark you for death. But let's keep going here. So here's again, this was one of the first pictures ever taken. Just to give you all a little thing, I know we covered this last week, but I'm going to just show you real quick. Illinois, April 23rd, 1950. China, 1960. India, 1964. Russia, 1995. Puerto Rico, 1988. I can't remember where that one was, but. So does that look like flying cylinders? And of course, it's still going on. This was this week. In fact, when I pulled it up day before yesterday, it was 4 hours old. Mysterious UFO seen in the sky as NASA prepares report on suspicions about aliens. Huh. Surprise, surprise. Look at that weird-looking thing. Now, let's continue in Zechariah 5. We didn't continue in it last week, but there's a little more information here. So this is Zechariah 5. Right after he talks about this, the curse and these flying scrolls, and remember, these are visions to be interpreted. And I believe a lot of these visions that we were given both in the Old Testament and in the New, particularly in Revelation, we weren't going to understand them until the end. In fact, Daniel said that these things would be concealed until the time of the end. So now we're beginning to understand what they are. All right? But he goes on to say, and here's another vision he has. He says, "Then the angel that talked with me went forth, and said unto me, lift up now thine eyes and see what it is that goeth forth. So remember, he just said, this is the curse that goes forth through the whole earth. Now he says, I want you to look up your eyes. I want you to see what's going forth. And he gives you another illustration. And he said, and I said, what is it? And he said, this is an ephah that goeth forth. He said, moreover, this is their resemblance through all the earth. Remember that. This is an ephah, and this is their resemblance through the whole earth. He says, and behold, there was lifted up a talent of lead. I believe this is showing that they would look metallic. All right? We'll get more to that. And he says, and this is a woman that sitteth in the midst of the ephah. Wait a minute. This lead and this woman. We'll get more to that. And he said, look here. This is wickedness. Somebody say wickedness. This is wickedness. This is a term about the Antichrist, because it says in 2 Thessalonians 2, then shall that wicked be revealed, whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth. And I believe this alien deception is connected to the bringing forth of the Antichrist. All right? But that's a whole other thing. He said, this is wickedness, and he cast it into the midst thereof of the ephah, and he cast the weight of the lead of the mouth upon it there. And he said, then lifted up my eyes and looked, and behold, and there came out two women, and the wind was in their wings, for they had wings like the wings of a stork. This is a stork is an unclean animal in the old covenant. So these are unclean spirits. And they lifted up the ephah between the earth and heaven, so in the sky. And then said I to the angel that talked with me, whither do these bear the ephah? And he said unto me, to build it a house in the land of Shinar, and it shall be established and set thereupon her own base. Now, I could get into this for a bit, but I want to show you what an ephah looks like from ancient Israel. This is their resemblance through the whole earth. Everybody see that? What's that look like? Yeah, it looks like those flying saucers, doesn't it? Now, granted, they're beginning, that's the main shape they'll take. But sometimes they'll take the shape of a sphere, a metallic sphere. Sometimes it's weird triangle shapes. They'll do all kinds of stuff. But this is the main shape they've revealed themselves in. Now, this is the verse we had last week. We're going to read it again. Let it sink down in you. Now, the Spirit speaketh expressly that in the latter times, the last days, some shall depart from the faith, giving heed or listening to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils. That's 1 Timothy 4:1. Now, here we have, look at this, Mr. Harvard physicist searching for UFO evidence says humanity will view alien intelligence like God. Now, does this look like some weird lunatic fringe conspiracy theorist? No. They're putting this on the main news here, right? Just wanted you to see, this is pretty recent here, just 4 days ago. 4 or 5 days ago. Now, here's the verse I didn't give you last week, but I'm going to give you this week here. But it says here, Jesus was speaking about the signs of his coming at the end of the age, and he said, for there shall arise false Christ. I want you to notice that that is plural. We always think about, we read that, and we think about the Antichrist, the one false Christ. No, he said there's going to be false Christ. Well, what does the word Christ mean? Savior, right? Messiah figure. So he's going to say there's going to be false saviors. Oh, the space brothers are being called our saviors. They're going to come save mankind. For there shall arise false Christ and false prophets. Huh. Kind of like, you know, Stephen Greer. Because prophets speak for their saviors, right? Jesus warned, though, for there shall arise false Christ and false prophets, and they will show great signs and wonders. Great. Somebody say great. Great. Don't just read over this. Great. It's going to get greater, bigger. They're going to show great signs and wonders insomuch that if it were possible, they shall deceive the very elect. Now, a lot of people say, well, that just means that the very elect won't be deceived. You know what elect means? I know this. I know that Carl thinks it means that some are chosen to go to heaven and some are chosen to go to hell. Nobody can do anything about that. That's Calvinism. No, elect means just means you are God's favorite, one of his favorites. That's all it means. And you know what? You can decide whether you're going to be one of his favorites or not. I mean, y'all know there's children and grandchildren. There's grandchildren that, you know, hit you over the head with a bat and try to kill the dog. And then there's grandchildren that love to run up and sit in your lap and love on you. I'm sorry, but it's easy to pick a favorite right there. Doesn't mean you don't love the other one. You see what I'm saying? Doesn't mean you don't love the other one. But you got a different kind of relationship with that one. Right? Well, Jesus says, I've warned you. And I believe that too, those that are the very elect, the ones that have chosen to get close to God and sit in his lap and love Jesus with all their heart, soul, mind, and strength and love the word of God are not going to be deceived, but many are. As we just read, this is not saying that believers can't fall away or won't fall away. We've already read the scripture. Some will depart from the faith because they will listen to these deceiving spirits and doctrines of devils. But you, Fire and Grace Church, and those watching us, are being warned of these deceptions. All right, let's keep going. Now, 2 Corinthians 11:14 makes this statement very clear. And no marvel, or don't be surprised, for Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light. Satan will try to transform himself and to appear to be an angel of light, a good messenger. In fact, this manifestation here is one at Dr. Greer's contact ET events. Their CE5 events, where they call on these things to appear. But what does that look like to you? Does that look like an angel of light to you? Yeah, it's a deceiving one. Oh, there's people they're out there crying. Oh, there's one man that got healed out there. There's demonic healing as well. Signs and wonders, I'm telling you, they're doing them. We're going to get into Dr. Greer here in a minute. But when I started digging back into this again just a couple of weeks ago, I ran across this right here when I typed in contact with extraterrestrials. Can anybody see what site that's on there? Somebody say NSA.gov. And it's actually fairly old. This is a transcript. But it's on the NSA website right now. Communication with Extraterrestrial Intelligence by a Lambros D. Calamojos, I guess. That's how you say his name. This guy was one of the, how do I put it? He was one of the top dogs in the NSA. He was the main cryptologist, you could say there, okay, for many years. And he gave a speech, and this is the speech, Communication with Extraterrestrial Intelligence, and then he says here, point blank, we are not alone in the universe. A few years ago, this notion seemed far-fetched. Today, the existence of extraterrestrial intelligence is taken for granted. This is in the 1970s. And he says, even the State National Academy of Sciences has gone on record that contact with other civilizations is no longer something beyond our dreams, but a natural event in the history of mankind that will perhaps occur in the lifetime of many of us. He goes on, says, Sir Bernard Lavelle, one of the world's leading radio astronomers, has calculated that even allowing for a margin of error of 5,000%, there must be in our galaxy about 100 million stars which have planets of the right chemistry, dimensions, and temperature to support organic evolution. If we consider that our galaxy, the Milky Way, is but one of at least a billion other galaxies similar to ours in the observable universe, the number of stars that could support some form of life to reach a word astronomical. So here's what they're saying. Now, here's this guy. You can see NSA website. He's a historical figure for them. Mr. Calamojos won the world renowned as a flute virtuoso before serving in the Army Cryptologic Unit in World War II. The author of many textbooks, monograph studies, articles, including the ones on cryptology in the World Book Encyclopedia. He was with the NSA. He taught NSA senior course for crypt analysis for 20 years. All right. Now, why am I bringing this guy up? This guy, high in the intelligence community, high in the government, known as a, you know, a Renaissance man. Where did he give this speech? To the NSA? No. He gave this speech to a club I didn't even know anything about. It's called the Cosmos Club in Washington, D.C. Founded in 1878, the Cosmos Club is a private social club for men and women distinguished in science, literature, the arts, learned professions, or public service. Our club provides a welcoming environment to share in scholarship, conversation, and culture. We are proud to welcome our members and guests. This is a swanky place, man. But I want you to see here, to become a member of the Cosmos Club, an individual must demonstrate distinction in their prospective artistic, scientific, literary, public service, or professional career. Our members have included 3 presidents, 2 vice presidents, 14 Supreme Court justices, 36 Nobel Prize winners, 61 Pulitzer Prize winners, and 55 recipients of the Presidential Medal of Freedom, and the list continues on. This is who he gave that speech to in the 1970s. I'm saying this because I want you to see the elite, the leaders, the rulers of this world, the wealthy. They've been talking about this for a long time. They believe this lie because they've believed the Copernican heliocentric lie. They have to have that lie, right? Because they're just playing off of probability. But they're deceived. And we're going to cover more of that next week about where it started. How many of you know? Did anybody know that this whole concept of this vast, ever-expanding universe, billions and billions of galaxies and hundreds of millions of light years. Do you have any idea where that started? Everybody thinks it started with Copernicus. No. I'm going to show you next week. But it was the Roman Catholic Church long before Copernicus. Well, there it is. There's that. It's just so they can see it out there. So this is a swanky club. So 1970s, they're being told by a top NSA official, Renaissance man, we are not alone in the universe. Now, if you're sitting there as Mr. and Miss, you know, high society, and this man gives you this speech, and I only gave you just a clip of it. It's much longer. Do you think he's giving credibility? He's with the NSA. They know things, right? They spy on all of us. Let's watch this video real quick. This is Dr. Greer. We're going to do several clips of Dr. Greer. I watched the whole 2 hours, y'all. Close Encounters of the Fifth Kind. Y'all pray for me. Very interesting, though. Here we go.
Something strange is happening. We are living through the most extraordinary moment in human history. After decades of denial and ridicule, government officials and the mainstream media are admitting that extraterrestrial civilizations are visiting Earth. But there's a twist. The same people and institutions who lied about ETs and just about everything else are now framing the extraterrestrial presence as a threat.
And we are seriously thinking of the Space Force.
One man has been trying to warn us about this for decades.
If you're seeing this, it's because I am either dead or have been entrapped or have disappeared.
Most of us are ill-prepared for open contact with an advanced ET civilization. As our expanding cosmology outgrows our theological institutions, modern human society is spiraling into decadence, narcissism, depravity, and nihilism.
Catch me outside, how about that?
If we want to truly understand ETs, their technology, and their intentions, we have to readdress our assumptions about the nature of reality and our relationship with the physical universe.
On the surface, oh, UFOs are real, there are these machines zipping through the sky. But one of the things I've always said is, well, that's interesting. And it's cool, and it's great to see them. But what's really interesting are the people on board those spacecraft. They're intelligent, they're conscious, they're here, they're interested. Why are they here otherwise? But no one has made the question, how do we develop that relationship with the occupants of the UFOs? That's what this is about. It's going from just sort of a materialistic view, there's a machine flying around the sky, and sort of a superficial view of it, to a deeper truth of who's on board? Why are they here? What is their relationship to humanity, perhaps the origins of the human race? What are we to do to create a relationship with them, and how do we do that? What is the foundation of a relationship between humans at this stage of our evolution and in civilizations that are hundreds of thousands to millions of years more developed technologically and socially and perhaps in consciousness? We have to find where that point of commonality is. I have put a briefing together for every president since Bill Clinton, and to the extent that they know anything, it doesn't mean they have control over these covert programs. The unacknowledged special access projects are run in a way that they are outside the purview and control of the president or the Congress. And for that reason, our elected representatives are unlikely to resolve this problem, but we can resolve it by going directly to these civilizations and saying, we're here. You can make contact with us. We're unarmed. We are friendly.
Since 1990, a network of free thinkers and renegades have been bypassing the national security state to make direct contact with advanced extraterrestrial civilizations. Using the Close Encounters of the Fifth Kind protocols, or CE5, developed by Dr. Greer, this has proven to be the most subversive and dangerous information he has released to the public.
Oh my gosh.
Dude, this is all type shit right now, man. Talk about looking at shit right now. Oh my god, look at this. These three lights, they keep coming together. And then they... All right, watch this. Look at them. Look at them. Look at them. Boom.
Close Encounters of the First Kind consists of visual sightings of an unidentified flying object. Close Encounters of the Second Kind, some physical trace is present, like impressions in the ground or scorched vegetation. Close Encounters of the Third Kind, the occupants or pilots of an ET craft are witnessed. Close Encounters of the Fourth Kind, a human is brought on board an ET craft. Close Encounters of the Fifth Kind, proactive human-initiated communication with extraterrestrial beings. Most of the phenomena presented in this film were photographed or recorded during a CE5 contact event. For thousands of people, contact has begun. This is their story.
Got on the radar of the intelligence community, and they knew that we had come across the Rosetta Stone. of contacting and communicating with interstellar civilizations, and it worked. That is what started the intelligence community coming after what we were saying and doing and trying to intercept it. This is, in fact, cosmic disobedience on a grand scale. We're going to bypass the sociopaths in these covert programs and do this directly. It's the same thing with the civil rights movement. The civil rights movement would have never happened from the top down. Even the Kennedy brothers did not want to step into that mess. It took a mass of people, not just Martin Luther King, but millions of people all over the country doing sit-ins and lunch counter sit-ins and buses and what have you to change that direction of our civilization out of Jim Crow onto a society that is, while not perfect, is more open and inclusive than it was. Well, the same has to happen here. And to do that, we have to understand what cosmic consciousness is and what the nature of the cosmic mind is that is resonating within every single human being. Because that's the foundation for the relationship between humans and these civilizations. By doing it directly, all of us are going to know what the truth is. You don't have to go through a proxy or someone who's telling you secondhand. But it also creates a movement globally to show these civilizations that there are people on this planet who are enlightened and conscious and peaceful, which is the majority of humans. Because real disclosure is humans making contact with these civilizations directly. And these civilizations are waiting for us to do it. And so this is our opportunity. This is our moment. And it really is we, the people, that have to do it.
Now, I know that was a long clip, but y'all needed to see that. We've got a couple of others. But I want you to see, do you notice that this is a religion? I mean, these are people that it's amazing. It's like the devil is, you know how we toy with a cat with a laser pointer? It's like these people, since they rejected Jesus Christ, they rejected the God of creation, now they're open to just be toyed with by Satan and his demonic forces. And I want you to remember that little triangle pattern. We're going to look at that more in just a second. But there's another clip here I want you to see. And I usually don't play clips back to back. Am I going the right direction here? Let's see, is that it?
One exception, yes, to the almost universal failure of world governments to initiate peaceful diplomacy with ET civilizations took place in France in 2007. Then President Sarkozy's Ministry of Defense reached out to Dr. Greer to train its senior officials in the Close Encounters of the Fifth Kind protocols. During a covert test run in the French countryside, ET craft were tracked overhead going 200,000 kilometers per hour. And this massive mauve-colored craft partially materialized a few meters from the group. Since the operation was swiftly halted by national security state interests, it remains the duty of we the people to become peaceful ambassadors to the universe. Much like a denial of service cyber attack can bottleneck and bring down a computer network, millions of people initiating contact would completely overwhelm the national security state's ability to subvert disclosure.
The national security state people, and potentially working with and through the To the Stars Academy, are going to be pitching this problem, saying, well, you know, we can't just let our whole civilization know that there is this highly advanced, technologically superior society out there, and because our whole culture will collapse. Whereas, in fact, it's quite clear that it's their defense of the elite, this 1% of the human family that basically ends up controlling over 40% of all of the wealth on the planet, that they're really defending. And it's their world that they're trying to defend. So that you see that this is a subset of a larger question about how spiritual consciousness and the evolution of consciousness, of understanding what we really are in the makeup of the universe, is a threat in itself to this elite. Because that is the dissolving away of these kind of differences among ourselves and this coming into a full ownership of our proper place in the universe puts these people out of business as the ruling elite. And so that the raising of consciousness of our human family is so closely related to the opening onto the extraterrestrial experience that both of them together are viewed as a threat by the elite. What they're afraid of is that this is such an accelerator, as people have these repeated contacts with the extraterrestrials, their whole consciousness starts to rise. They start becoming aware of the fact that we're damaging our environment. They can become aware of the fact that nuclear weapons are kind of an insane thing to have. War is a really bad idea. This is a spiritual experience. It's a spiritual stimulation that's coming.
If you take someone from Italy and someone from Japan, very different cultures, very different people, personalities, backgrounds, emotional temperament. Now, extrapolate that out across the cosmos. Think of the vast differences we're going to be. How do we make any sense of that if we aren't anchored into something deeper? And that point of commonality has been folded within each of us. And that is, we are awake, conscious beings. They are awake, we are awake. That faculty of being aware of awareness, the consciousness, not what you're conscious of, but the means to be awake. That is a singularity. And once we're anchored into that state of consciousness, the unitive state, then there aren't any aliens. There are just other people who are a little different from us. This is the point where we can make contact most easily.
Okay, so I wanted you to hear it from them, because that's their lawyer, the guy with the white hair. Now, this whole ruse that they're against the military-industrial complex, all that's a bunch of nonsense, okay? You understand, they're playing the white hat, the good cop, bad cop scenario on you. Now, granted, Greer and his buddies, they may be deceived in thinking they're white hats because they're full of New Age la-di-da demons, but whatever may be the case, bottom line, this thing they keep talking about, this consciousness, it's interesting that it has to be developed and tapped into by Hindu Buddhist type meditation. And I'm going to show you where Dr. Greer got his training from. Here's a Gaia article. You know, they're big into all of this Mother Earth, New Age, ET stuff, but this is an article from August 11th, 2021. Dr. Stephen Greer's CE5 protocols led to mass UFO sighting. If you scroll down here, and I'm going to read it for you, but it says this. He says, it is possible to contact extraterrestrials. He said, is it rather possible to contact extraterrestrials telepathically? According to the experiences of Dr. Stephen Greer, and a specific set of rules he calls the close encounter of the fifth kind CE5 protocols, you can. And he has stories to prove it. In the summer of 1975, Dr. Greer went to Maharishi International University to study transcendental meditation and to become a teacher of it. Everybody remember that. The Maharishi. Right? This is the same one. I did two messages on this few years ago on the transcendental meditation that's sweeping Hollywood and all of our business elite and even being taught at the Vatican. Anyway, it says in the summer of 1975, Dr. Greer went to Maharishi International University to study transcendental meditation and become a teacher. During the last phase of his training, he took a retreat with some fellow students to Isola, France, a small resort town in the Maritime Alps near the border of Italy. Dr. Greer said that at one point he decided to go off on his own and practice his CE5 protocols, which he says he co-created with an extraterrestrial entity during a contact experience as a young adult. Part of these protocols involves going into deep states of meditation and opening up one's consciousness to the possibility of contact with beings from elsewhere in the universe. This type of meditation has always opened people to contact to other beings. It's not extraterrestrials or aliens. They're called demons and Satan at masquerade as angels of light. He said, basically, he says, but once this is done, the meditator then asks any extraterrestrial entities to make contact while guiding them with a specific vector to their location. This involves universally, galactically, within our solar system, planet, country, and so on. Having mentally scanned the galaxies for any signs of extraterrestrial life, Dr. Greer said he believed he had found a signal from some location directing whatever intelligence was there to his location in the French Alps. I tell you, I'm not making this stuff up, right? And then he says, before he knew it, a silver seamless tetrahedron materialized in the air on a day in which the sky was blue and there were few clouds. But it wasn't just Dr. Greer who witnessed the craft. In fact, this was the first mass sighting initiated by these CE5 protocols, though it certainly wouldn't be the last. Others in this group witnessed the massive tetrahedron floating in the midday sky, shocked by what they were seeing. But unsurprisingly, Dr. Greer's colleagues started to become afraid, as they had not been prepared to witness such incredible phenomenon. And at that moment, the craft disappeared. Blah, 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 blah. Anyway, we go on down. Directing ET craft to your precise location rather than a general vicinity is also important. As Dr. Greer learned during a solo CE5 meditation he conducted in North Carolina, in which an ET craft was tracked on the local airport's radar, eliciting reactions from the pilots in the area. No joke. And you can hear the recordings of the that. Now, let's look at Tim. This is from my message a few years ago, and I'm just going to have to read it. It's kind of small, but transcendental meditation and mantra meditations. Now, it says here, it says, although transcendental meditation, TM, has tried to keep the mantra secret, many lapsed instructors have revealed the following 16 are usually given, and it gives the different mantras. It says each of these mantras is given to a particular age group. It says, on inspection of these mantras, turn out to be seed mantras, magical invocations of the main Hindu gods. The first 8 mantras are variations of this one. I'm not even going to say them. And it goes on down the line. To understand the force of this, one should enter Hindu philosophy. The origins of the universe are thought to be linked to sounds. And here we go. It's very important to understand. Dr. Greer was trained by the Maharishi. He was trained in transcendental meditation, meaning he was given by his guru one of these mantras that is literally a prayer or a call to one of the Hindu gods, which are demons. All right? So let's understand that since 1975, at least, we know, Dr. Greer has been operating in the occult supernatural, in meditation techniques that use a mantra repeated over and over and over again until the mind blanks out and you enter a different state of consciousness. Satanic meditation is a blanking of the mind and usually uses repeated sounds, phrases, breaths, but it's whatever it takes to get you into a state where you kind of separate yourself from your active mind and body. And this is what leads to what's called astral projection or remote viewing, as it's called. And we'll talk more about that in next week's, but I want you to see this. And this is from that message I did a few years ago. The Maharishi knew that he was teaching Hinduism. And he said, for our practice, we select only the suitable mantras of personal gods. Such mantras fetch to us the grace of personal gods and makes us happier in every walk of life. The Maharishi admits directly that the transcendental meditation mantras not only are not meaningless, they are the names of Hindu gods such as, Chitra could help me on this, but anyway, you see them. And as he explains, the very reason that he uses these mantra names is not to inspire devotion, but to influence these gods to grant boons and material wealth to the transcendental meditators and so on. So, as you see, there it is. Even the Om is one of them. And here's a list of them. I'm not going to read through all this. I just want you to see I've done my due diligence, as they say. That's what I'm telling you, this research, man. But see, Jesus told us, and that's why God had me write the Polluted Church book. I wrote this in 2011, published it in 2012, but it's called The Polluted Church from Rome to Kansas City. And it's all about how these Hindu, Buddhist, Eastern meditation techniques that are satanic, that are demonic, how they work their way into the beginnings of the Catholic Church, and then how they've worked their way into, even now, a lot of mainstream charismatic and Baptist churches through what's called contemplative prayer, contemplative mysticism. I deal with this thoroughly on what is biblical meditation and what is satanic. But Jesus already told us not to pray like these people. Now let's read this. This is Matthew 6, 5 through 8. Jesus commanded us not to pray like them, but look what he says, when thou prayest, thou shalt not be as the hypocrites are, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and in the corners of the streets, that they may be seen of men. But verily I say unto you, they have their reward. But thou, when thou prayest, enter into thy closet, and when thou hast shut the door, pray to thy Father which is in secret, and thy Father which seeth in secret shall reward thee openly. But when you pray, use not vain repetitions as the heathen do, for they think that they shall be heard for their much speaking. They actually believe that they contact their gods by these repetitious phrases or mantras. And Jesus said, don't pray like this. So Christians, there are Christians that do this. They'll say, well, I'm saying Jesus 5,000 times in an hour. It's the same practice. Saying the Hail Mary over and over and over again. While the Roman Catholics have their rosary beads, which they got from Buddhist monks who were in the deserts in 250 A.D. as missionaries to count their prayers. Paganism, man. The Roman Catholic Church is just full of it. Somebody say it with me. When you pray, use not vain repetitions as the heathen do. Is that not clear? That's not a suggestion, by the way. It's a command. Because the moment you disobey this command, you open your mind, and that means your spirit and your soul is open to demonic forces to come in and begin to possess you and deceive you. I've seen it, folks, many times over. Let's keep going here. Now let's get to this guy. How many of you know who this guy is? There's a few of you know who this guy is. I could just run by this, but I think it's important because not everybody knows who Aleister Crowley is, but dubbed by the press as the wickedest man in the world. We have Edward Alexander Crowley, who changed his name to Aleister, was born October 12, 1875. He's primarily known for his occult writings and teachings. He studied Hindu and Buddhist practices in India. That is very important to remember. He studied Hindu and Buddhist practices in India before he went to Egypt and had the demon manifest to him, and he wrote the Book of the Law. It says he founded the religion of Thelema, which became adopted by the Ordo Templis Orientis, or OTO, as well as the Magical Order of Argentium Astrum, or AA, the Order of the Silver Star. He was also a highly controversial member of the Hermetic Order of the Golden Dawn, or he was known by the magical name of Frater Perdabo, or Turabo, I don't know what you say that. In 1904, he married Rose Edith Kelly, and they honeymooned in Cairo, Egypt, where Crowley claimed to have been contacted by a supernatural entity named Iwas, who provided him with the Book of the Law, a sacred text that served as the basis for his Thelema religion, announcing the start of the Aeon of Horus. The book declared that its followers should do what thou wilt and seek to align themselves with their true will through the practice of magic. Now, he wrote all kinds of books. He's very influential in the occult world, like Led Zeppelin and all these people, the Beatles, they all about him. I want you to see there's a book here about Aleister Crowley in India, The Secret Influence of Eastern Mysticism. So he's talking about Hindu Buddhist mysticism, their type of getting into different states of consciousness. Crowley was into this. Crowley was also, and we'll get more to this next week, but he also was in California with Jack Parsons of the Jet Propulsion Laboratory, who developed the rockets for the space program, who was a known Satanist. This is L. Ron Hubbard, who they all hung out together in the same house. This is what Hotel California was written about. And they all hung out in the same house doing all kinds of evil things and rituals. One was one they called Babylon Working. But this was the beginning, when they were together there in California, it was the beginning of the Satanic Church in California. And but a clear connection between Crowley and Jack Parsons that we'll deal with later. The occult is big time involved in NASA. Now, here's Lamb. Y'all want to know about Lamb? I showed a little picture of him last week, but I felt like the Lord wanted me to go into it deeper. So when Aleister Crowley was living in New York during various magical experiments in a place on West 9th, he did what was called the Alamantra working. It's theorized this process created a deliberate channel to ephemeral, I don't know some of these words, cosmic influence, so that extra-dimensional entities could enter our universe. In short, he likely created a portal for what we know as the gray aliens to come visit. Now, this is just a Vice article. Basically, he just invited demons and they showed up. Eventually, Crowley made contact with an entity known as Lamb, and he drew its portrait. And he said, man, it looks like a picture of the grays now. Incidentally, Lamb is the mantra linked to the root chakra, which is associated with survival. This was around, now think about this. This was around 1917. Did some other things start happening in 1917? Guess what happened? Fatima. Think it's a coincidence? Your most powerful occultist in the world is doing rituals to bring, open the door to entities, and all of a sudden, there's a mass sighting. And this is really, and then also think about the 1917 was when the czars were overthrown and communism rose to power in Russia. All kind of evil things started happening. But anyway, this around 1917, while there are possibly ancient accounts of extraterrestrial visitations in other parts of the world, this was one of the first known grays to have popped into the Western consciousness, although Crowley didn't explicitly say this. Now, it says Crowley introduced Lamb for the first time in his commentary on The Voice of the Silence by Theosophy founder Madame Blavatsky. Founded or not, he basically tears that classic to shreds without ever really explaining why he started off with this portrait of Lamb. Since then, Lamb's been expounded on by a writer named Kenneth Grant, who knew Crowley personally and is his acknowledged successor. And so this Kenneth Grant, Chad turned me on to him, but I found this. It was interesting. So here's the first edition of Madame Blavatsky's book, Book of the Golden Precepts here. Why do you think this triangle thing is on there?
It's also Nicholas Roark's Banner of Peace symbol.
Ah. It's amazing how this stuff is all... Why do we keep seeing these little triangle lights here? The linear directly, it's directly connected to these occultists, to these Satanists, to these mediums. Y'all see that? That was, in fact, that book, it's in Wikipedia. That was the one she sent personally to Tolstoy. All right? So this is part of history here. All right, let's keep going. Here's just some of those pictures. Look at there. This one. Top here, it was Texas. Then this was a later on reappeared in Texas at a different time, seen by many people. This is at one of Dr. Greer's CE5 events. This one and this one. This, they saw a, and this was at a Greer CE5, this crop circle manifestation. This is one of his events. They saw this orb go out over the field, and then the next day they saw this again, the same. Three little triangle symbols there. So, boom. So there's Lamb he drew, and there's a North Carolina abduction case sketch. Kind of similar. They kind of look like cousins. The scare you in the at night thing going on. Lamb was probably high. Let's go. Here we go. But there it is. There's Lamb is a mantra. Lamb is a mantra, y'all. It's a Hindu mantra. I'm gonna really crack y'all up here. It's a mantra for the root chakra. What's the root chakra? Well, the mantra, this mantra, the Lamb mantra, is associated with a, how do you say that, Chitra? Mulahada? I don't know. Anyway, this chakra is the first of the seven chakra energies. It's the root, foundation, base. This is the root chakra. It's situated between the perineum and the coccyx or the anus. So this is the butt mantra here. Lamb came from the butt mantra. And I hate to say that Crowley was into that as well. He goes on to say that, listen, this says right here, adepts say that chanting the Lamb mantra 100 million times will gain you all the, how do you say this? Siddhis? Meaning enlightenment or achievements regarding whatever. But I want you to see that. Lamb is that. So here's this guy who was Crowley's guy. In fact, Crowley gave him the original drawing of Lamb. So this is a book he wrote. I've been going through. Don't read this stuff, y'all. I'm serious. The only reason I do it is because I have to. All right? Because I'm showing you the connection to this whole thing. This is going back. Right? It's connected to all these occultists. And it says, this is in the introduction. It says, this book contains a critical study of Aleister Crowley's system of sexual magic and its affinities, or whatever it means there. There's some misspellings, I think. With the ancient, notice this, ancient tantric rites of Kali. Kali. Chitra, is that Hindu god? So he's saying he was into the Hindu gods. All right? The dark goddess of blood, dissolution, represented by Crowley's cult of the Scarlet Woman. I'm not going to read all that, but here we go. This goes on. This is in the same thing, but he says, as a result of many years of research into obscure phases of occultism, I have evolved a method of dream control for contacting extraterrestrial and non-human entities. So this Grant says, now think about this. This is long before Dr. Stephen Greer. So I think Dr. Stephen Greer might be lying a little bit. Or maybe he's not aware that there were others before him. And I went on and read some of this, and it's just basically how to blank out your mind and use daydreaming to finally blank out your mind until you're in that state of consciousness. But again, it's the same thing you're developing, whether it be in Buddhism or Hinduism. The Islamic Sufis do the very same thing, all right? But notice this. I want you to remember this. It says, so he developed a method of dream control for contacting extraterrestrial non-human entities. This forms the substance of chapter 6 and 7. This method is described in relation to the mysteries of Kundalini. Wait a minute. That's Hinduism again. Kundalini, remember that serpent power. I got a whole chapter in my book about astral projection and Kundalini. All right? And this is very important because it's going to come back to us in a minute. But the mysteries of Kundalini, the supreme magical power symbolized by the sleeping fire snake at the base of the spine, which after its awakening activates subtle power zones in the human body. So in the message I did years ago about the Hollywood people, I have a clip of Ringo Starr talking, giving an interview where he talks about studying and hanging out with the Maharishi and learning about the Kundalini awakening and shocks, right? All from transcendental meditation taught by the Hindu guru, the Maharishi, all right? All of this is connected. It's very important you know that all of this stays connected with one another. The occult is the occult world. Now, they might all have different little, emphasis, but they all share in the same stuff. All right? And here, remember the function of magic. Remember this. He says here, the function of magic. Magic is satanic. It's demonic. He says the function of magic is to liberate the conscience from the thraldom. That means the slavery of the individual existence. Now, he says it permits it to flow into cosmic immensity. I don't have the clip. I didn't pull the clip. But Greer says when he gets into his meditative state, He feels like he is a drop of water that drops into the ocean of the cosmic. Yeah. It's magic. It's demonic. Now let's watch this. Here we go. Now we see this.
It's useful for us to think about our own experience over the last couple hundred years. You go back 200 and some years and show Thomas Jefferson a modern smartphone. To anyone of that period, it would look like something that was magic.
Any sufficiently advanced technology is indistinguishable from magic. Arthur C. Clarke.
We're dealing with civilizations where almost every aspect of how they appear in our time space would look like magic to us. And in the CIA, this is actually called WSFM. Sounds like a radio station. It stands for Weird Science and Frickin' Magic. A spacecraft can be completely 3D like you see a solid aircraft. It can be partially in this dimension, but shifted mostly into another dimension. So I liken this to like when you're turning a dial on an old AM radio and you can move it across and you suddenly pick up Chicago and New York at the same time. They're bleeding together, dimensional bleeding. And so often these ET craft will be partially in this dimension, but mostly out. And all that we will detect in this dimension might be an electronic signature, orb, or an object that appears and flashes in and out, a scintillation of light that then vanishes, or an object that comes in where it looks almost like a hologram of an ET being that will be standing amongst us, but it's an electronically teleported version of that conscious being. I love this one. His name is Bijou. It's pronounced Bijou. He's an interstellar being from Andromeda, and he has a very bright looking nose because there is a orb here that teleported him onto the site. With the naked eye, the only thing that was seen was this sphere that came up right beside my shoulder.
What was amazing is there was a light kind of illuminating this being. He was just floating in sort of this energetic space, and it looked like he was waving at me.
He's sort of doing this, floating. He's in the air maybe 5 feet up. When I asked him where he was from, he said it was from Andromeda galaxy.
Sometimes I have to pinch myself and make sure, you know, I do a little self-check to make sure I'm just really seeing something or it's not my imagination, but that was a huge confirmation that, you know, we are really onto something with what we're doing, that we are really making contact. The ETs are participants in the whole story and this whole unfoldment. So it's really amazing that you're communicating with someone from, you know, an entirely different world, and you know, it's mind-boggling, really.
Now this is beautiful. We were on the beach and this appears right on the sand in front of me, and you can see the eyes very faintly. It's barely in this dimension. It's very crystalline. It's pitch black on this beach. This being highly intelligent, an extraterrestrial civilization at the level of the celestial. So it visualized humanity evolving to the point that everyone on Earth were in cosmic consciousness and enlightenment. That's what we're talking about. 500,000 to 1 billion years ahead of us. Get a load of this. We're in a deep meditation I'm leading. We're in cosmic consciousness. This is a Peruvian doctor, medical doctor. I call it the cosmic spermatozoa. It looks, and it comes in and it wraps around her, and she begins to have the kundalini and an enlightenment experience like she's never had. And of course, this happens a lot on these expeditions, but we got it on photograph. Isn't that cool? I love this one. It's just off the edge of the hill, and you see people turning to look. And it was this object that materialized into this dimension and lit up and then dematerialized. What I saw in my remote view was a very large craft filled with ETs from different civilizations that were joining us in the meditation. Because that's what they're interested in. They're interested if you have a pure heart, a clear intent, and you're wanting to join them in universal peace. That's it. They don't care about your degrees. They don't care about... This is what the Prince of Liechtenstein said. You know, I've gone all over the world where these UFOs are seen, and they're seen before I'm there and after, but when I'm there, they're not around. Maybe it's my attitude. I said, bingo.
Every experience that could be, that was described, no matter how unbelievable, in Dr. Rear's books or the manuals, we've experienced them ourselves. And someone snapped a photo with their iPad, beams of energy in...
Yeah, it could go on. But there's your picture. Think about that. That's what appears. Look at the big elongated head. They're letting you know. Now think, just think. Now the anytime you had any kind of true Christian around, what are they going to go? That's a demon. But these people are falling hook, line, and sinker for this thing. But it is a religion. And they're having their spiritual experiences, and they have their own prayer and their own meditation and their own angels and their own gods. So here's this guy. I'm going to read a couple of, just give you a few more mediums and good. It's only 5 after 12, so yeah, we're doing good here. Popular New Age author Brad Steiger, who for decades has tracked numerous messages from alleged aliens, often called Space Brothers, offers such messages in his book, The Fellowship, as an alternative to traditional Christianity. I wanted you to see that. This is from the book I quoted last week, The UFO, Friends, Foes, or Fantasy by Goetz. But his book, and I haven't read this guy's book, but a substitute, an alternative to traditional Christianity. He writes, "People of Earth, you are becoming fourth dimensional, whether you are ready or not. Leave the old to those who cling to the old, I guess you say. Don't let the new age pass you by. The space beings are doing all they can to help mankind, but they cannot force themselves on us or take control of the conditions here, however bad things might be. Contactees have been told that the space beings hope to guide Earth to a period of great unification, when all races will shine, discriminatory separations, and all humankind will recognize its discriminatory separations. Its responsibility to every other life form existing on the planet. The space beings also seek to bring about a single, solidified government." Ooh, one world government. Yeah. It says, the space beings seek to bring about a single, solidified government which will conduct itself on spiritual principles and permit all of its citizens to grow constructively in love. Well, the United Nations has its spiritual principles, and it's called the principles of Miss Alice Bailey and Helen Blavatsky, and we've covered that before. But let's keep going here. Here's another one. Ruth Montgomery, who became famous internationally in the 1960s through her book, A Gift of Prophecy, which is the biography of the psychic Jean Dixon, who apparently foretold President Kennedy's assassination. Since then, Montgomery has devoted her attention to psychic matters and has written a great many books on the subject. By her own admission, she engages in occult activities. I'm sorry, y'all, it was 3 o'clock in the morning. Having their own spirit guides who communicate with her through automatic writing. She was introduced to her spirit guides when famed medium Arthur Ford showed her how to do automatic writing daily sessions. This is one of the messages she gives from her spirit guides. "We are all one. Our space brothers and sisters share with us a mutual creator. The more enlightened among us earthlings have had numerous lives on other planets as well as on Earth. A large group of spacelings have volunteered to become walk-ins through the utilization of unwanted human forms." Wonder what she's talking about. It continues, she ended up, the guides made her write this book, Aliens Among Us, which is about UFOs and extraterrestrials, in that she says, "We human souls all began simultaneously as sparks from God, as did the souls in other galaxies. Space beings are now rushing into Earth as seldom before to awake Earthlings and to help them realize that unless better ways to settle disputes come forth where they're found, destruction is imminent." Then follows some 200 pages more where she talks about, you know, walk-ins again, long messages from Space Brothers. Among other things, they recommend the use of crystals for power and healing and success. Kind of the same stuff we see witches doing, right? Now, here's her mentor, Mr. Ford, Arthur Ford. He was a spiritualist, a psychic, and a medium. And it's really clear. He says he gained national attention when he claimed to have contacted the dead son of Bishop James Pikes in 1967. He was a medium. He was a fortune teller. He had a familiar spirit. But this is who trained her. This is who trained Ruth Montgomery. What does Ruth Montgomery come forth with? Space beings. You just need to see the room. Then this guy. I did a message about this guy in like 2010, I think, or 11. Benjamin Cram. He's the one, his big thing. Now, he died a few years ago. But his big thing is that he's been a prophet for what he calls the Lord Maitreya, or the great world teacher that's coming. He's been like the John the Baptist. Now, the Maitreya is just the term that the Buddhists would use, or the fifth Buddha is what he's called. The Antichrist will be called the fifth Buddha. The Maitreya, he will be called the Krishna. He will be called the Imam Mahdi, or the 12th Imam, and to deceive Christians, the Christ. But in all of his channeling, which he's a trance channeler, and all his channeling about the coming world leader, who's going to be a supernatural person, he decided to write this book in 2010, The Gathering of the Forces of Light, UFOs and Their Spiritual Mission. And what does he talk about through this whole thing? They're here to help us. They're coming here, and he quotes it after one after the other after the other. So I had this slide last week. This is one Chad gave me, but it's so good. The endless messages from the space people would now fill a library, and while the communicators claim to represent some other world, the contents of those messages are identical to the messages long received by what? Mediums and mystics, Roman Catholic mystics too. Now let's read Deuteronomy here. Deuteronomy 18, 10 through 13. There shall not be found among you anyone that maketh his son or his daughter to pass through the fire, or that uses divination. That means you're trying to foretell the future. Okay? Or an observer of times, or an enchanter, or a witch, or a charmer, or a consulter with familiar spirits, or a wizard, or a necromancer, those that contact the dead, which they're not contacting the dead, it's just demons appearing and fooling them that it's someone who has died. For all that do these things are an abomination unto the Lord, and because of these abominations, the Lord thy God doth drive them out from before thee. Thou shalt be perfect with the Lord thy God. Now that's as clear as it gets, isn't it? Now, I want everybody, I'm not trying to sell books, but I'm going to tell you, if you want to be ready for next week, if you haven't read Polluted Church, shame on you. Shame, 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 double shame on you. I think I have church members that probably still haven't read it yet.
Oh.
Now, our students have to read it. And let me tell you, the Lord made me write this. And the reason I'm saying this is because you need to understand how this move into what they call the Christ consciousness, or the cosmic consciousness, or the universal consciousness, or this talking about raising of consciousness. You need to understand it always incorporates meditation, visualization, mantras, always. And if you've done any of that, I want to tell you right now, there's a lot of Christians that have done it. They think because it has you slap Christian names on it and do the same techniques, they think it's okay. But it's not. It's opening people up to demons. But isn't it interesting, that demon kundalini snake they caught on film, isn't that something? Yeah. I've cast that demon out of people. It's a vicious little demon. And they showed it coming right up, slithering up to that woman. And even admit it's kundalini. She was having a kundalini experience. How is it? Why is it? Now, why would you, if you're trying to convince us that these are beings from other planets and galaxies, why would you admit that they're giving people Hindu manifestations in their lives from Hinduism, Buddhism? Again, when I believe what the Lord wanted me to get across to you this week, just take it a little deeper, is that all of this stuff, all of this extraterrestrial, like last week I talked about, you know, the Maria Orsic and the Vril Society and how we're talking about how they started, they were mediums. They were openly mediums, witches with familiar spirits into divination and all this stuff. And all of a sudden, they start getting messages from galaxies far, far away. It's always connected, folks, to occult practices or the practices of false religions that Christians should know are false and demonic. We shouldn't be tricked by any of this. But the Roman Catholic Church has let this slip in. They actually adopted it. And now, and this is why it's so important. Look, folks, this is why it's so important for any true Protestant Christian. You can have no compromise with the Roman Catholic system. None. Zero. You don't let them lay hands on you. You don't pray like they pray. You don't take their crosses, their crucifixes, their rosary beads, nothing. When I do deliverance, over the last, I would say, 10, 12 years, the strongest demonic manifestations, where the demons get really riled up and manifest in somebody and do something crazy when they're getting cast out in Jesus' name, is usually people who have been in Roman Catholicism. When I start addressing the demons of Roman Catholic idolatry to Mary and bind those demons and command them to come out, I've had one person, when I did that, blood began to shoot from her nose like it was a faucet turned on. Then she threw up stuff she didn't eat for dinner, because I know, because I ate dinner with her. We've had others. Chitra, you don't mind me saying, when we did Chitra's deliverance, Chitra is from India. She has a Hindu background, but she went to Roman Catholic school. And when we got to her deliverance and got to the Roman Catholic demon of Mary idolatry, she couldn't even speak. Her whole body seized up. She couldn't do it. I kept trying to get her to speak, and she couldn't speak. So I had to take authority and command that thing to come out. It was the strongest manifestation. None of the Hindu stuff, but the Roman Catholic demon was the worst. So if you've been in Roman Catholicism, or any of this stuff, you've gotten into the New Age. The New Age movement is nothing but the adoption of these Eastern mysticism occult principles put with new names on them. Sometimes they just say what it is. Like, yes, he's having a Kundalini awakening, but it's an alien. No, it's a demon. It's a demon. It's that serpent. I mean, think about it. The word Kundalini means serpent power. That old serpent, the devil. I mean, it shouldn't be hard to figure out. But I'm going to close with this, because you know what? Next week will probably be longer. But I want y'all to understand. I'm going to give y'all, this is the short one of the three. But you know, Dr. Rebecca Brown, in her book, He Came to Set the Captives Free, I know she's been slandered like nobody's business on the internet, but I knew the woman. She helped me through my deliverance. Then I invited her years later to come do services in Montgomery. Me and another pastor joined our churches together and had her and her husband come. I spent the whole week with her and her husband. The anointing of God was all over her. And her book, He Came to Set the Captives Free, she talks about the different scenarios of deliverance and open doorways. And she said that there was one lady that came to her, and she was clearly having demonic problems. She said, I can't read the Bible. I open the Bible and I pass out. Or I'd go blank, or I can't do it. She said, I used to could. And she's, you know, Dr. Brown starts asking her questions and trying to figure out where the doorway got open. And she said, well, I mean, has anything weird happened in your life? And she said, well, she said, I did see a UFO one time. Listen to this. She said she was driving in her car, and this orb of light started following along her car, like she was out in the country. And this thing, she was driving down the road, and she said, now listen, this was the open door. She says, I was always been fascinated by UFOs. No, you're not fascinated with demonic manifestations. You understand me? But see, that means that her mind was accepting, well, maybe there are other beings and other from other planets. And so she said that that she was interested in it. She said, so she communicated with it with her mind. And it communicated back. And there you go. She said, and then she asked it if it served the Lord Jesus Christ, who died on the cross and rose again. She said, then it disappeared. But see, she didn't realize that she had opened the door by talking to the thing. And because she was curious. Notice, remember in the book of Ephesians, it calls the satanic occult arts, it calls them curious arts. A lot of people get lured in because of curiosity. Remember, curiosity killed the cat? Yeah. You don't get curious about demonic stuff. Oh, let me just toy with it. No, you don't toy with it. You don't take anything of it into your possession. You don't communicate with it. You bind it, rebuke it, and command it to leave you in Jesus' name. See, the moment that orb appeared, she should have just said, in Jesus' name, I bind you, demon. Go for me. It would have vanished. All right? But Rebecca Brown, Dr. Brown, prayed for her, bound the demons that came in through the UFO encounter, and commanded it to leave, and it left her, and she went home, and she said, I can read the Bible again. I'm free again. So isn't it amazing? Again, I could go through case after case after case after case that what we're seeing in the skies, this whole UFO phenomena, this whole alien thing, they are demon spirits, fallen angels, and some of them, they may have Satan, and some of the others may have had relations with human women and created some more Nephilim, but they may not be giants. They just may be weird. And now with all the genetic manipulation that can be done, there's no telling what they can pretty much probably make whatever they want. I do know this. I was told in 1987 by someone coming out of high level of Satanism, and this is before the internet, I was told that the giants are underground. So giants are going to come out. Anybody see that massive Hummer the other day? Where the tires are taller than that right there? And they go, oh, it was just built to be an RV. See if you can find that big thing. So that's it's on Jonathan Moore's, it was on his Facebook page. I might have scrolled down a little bit. See if you can find it. But anyway, the moment I saw that thing, I said, for the Nephilim when they come out. That's for the giants when they come out. They had it designed. Well, no, on the inside, it's just an RV. Oh, yeah, you build a Hummer to be an RV that you can't even drive on the road. Nah. This looked like those things that, like, where they're mining and they're moving massive, you know, amount of dirt, and they've got these big machines out there. But those are designed where a man, normal-sized man, gets in them and drives them. It looked like that. It's insane. So I believe there will be giants again, and I believe that there's also others. You know, when we look back on the Nephilim, when the giants came into being, and we look back and how, you've got to remember, the first set was fallen angels, human women. So you had that group. But then you had them with each other, which created a different type of mutation. Then you had them with other mutations. And that's why we had, remember, the giants, some of them had six fingers and six toes and double sets of teeth. And some of them were normal size. I believe a lot of the elongated skulls that are all over the world have been determined that they're not from manipulation, that they're different. I believe that those are just a different genetic manifestation of Nephilim. So they're going to bring this. Yeah, there you go. Now, a regular size Hummer is big. What is that? And what is that for? I mean, most people have no need for this. I can't imagine that. That's for somebody a little bigger. Kind of like the steps and stuff in Egypt and other places that were clearly not for normal sized men. Look at that. Yep. Yep, they slap you in on that real quick, can't they? I guarantee you some space brothers are going to be riding in those, right? Yeah. Well, yeah. Oh, no. That's next week. We got the actually got the guy talking about that. Yeah, they won't. He was talking about, Pastor Troy was talking about, yeah, the Phil Schneider and some of the others that talk about being in the underground bases and these entities being down there. And they're ordered. In fact, some of them have to sign papers ahead of time saying they will not use the name of Jesus, even if they're cussing, because these entities lose it. Well, what does that tell you? Really? I mean, we ought to know, if it upsets them that bad, whose side are they on if you can't even say the name of Jesus around them? So get ready. Y'all, you know, the Bible talks about, you know, and I shared it last week, that fearful sights. Remember? Phobotron. Remember? The word phobotron. Fearful sight. Think about some of these things walking out. Even when these alleged aliens walk out, or baby Nephilim, we'll call them, or giant Nephilim walk out. Dude, there are going to be people who mess up their pants and run home crying mama. They are going to freak out. What about they manifest some type of ship, massive ship over a city? You think people aren't going to freak out? Man, there's going to be some freaking out. You should never, as a Christian, never be deceived by any of this. And be ready. Know your authority. Because I'm going to tell you right now, those things aren't going to want to get around you. And I really believe that that's why they have been held off. They always talk about it's not the right time. There's not enough people with their awakened, their conscience, to this consciousness. But I can tell you what it is. They've been waiting and waiting and waiting for the Church of Jesus Christ and Christians to get weaker and weaker and weaker. That don't pray, that don't bind demons, that don't believe in casting out demons, that don't believe in supernatural manifestations of things, that just go to their mega church and drink their coffee and go home. No, what they're afraid of is people like us who know. We know Jesus. We are born again through faith in his blood, faith in his bodily resurrection from the dead. He has filled us with his Holy Spirit. We understand we have authority and power in Jesus' name, and we can bind demons, rebuke demons in Jesus' name, and they have to flee from us, because that's what the Word of God says. Amen. 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 We can cast them out. And it doesn't matter if they call themselves Lamb or Space Brother or Legion or whatever. You know, some of these so-called aliens are calling themselves like Simjaza, like the name of one of the angels in Enoch that fell, that rebelled, and then went and made the oath to go mess up the human race genetically. They're just taking their name. Some of them will say They're Molech. Like, why are you telling us your name? Give us something else. Lamb. I mean, I just think that's amazing. A Hindu mantra. Yeah, my name is Lamb. I'm the butt demon. Isn't it crazy? That whole chakra thing, man. Anyway, that's all demonic stuff. Amen? Let's stand. Hallelujah. It's only been an hour and a half. I don't know. Let's do something. Let's do I See the Lord. I like that one. We're going to do a song before we leave. Did you learn anything today? If anything, I felt like some of it may have been a little redundant and covering stuff from last week, but you need to understand these connections to this stuff. The whole UFO alien thing is always can be traced back to some medium, some occultist, some sorcerer. Always. That's their origin. So don't be deceived. Amen. Because it's coming. They're going to march them out here pretty soon. Look, our space brothers are here to help us. They told us that Jesus is not the what the Christians say. It's what's exactly what they're going to do. And a lot of people are going to go, oh, we knew it. We hate those Christians. You know, Aleister Crowley was raised in a Christian home. Y'all know that? His father was a minister. He hated Christianity. So he hates Christianity, and he goes down this road, and what's he introduce us to? Entities from other places. Yep. Let's worship the Lord for a minute, and then we'll get out of here. Jesus Christ, King of kings, Lord of lords. The blasphemy that comes out of these people, that he is an E.T., that he is just a avatar, that he is just a, you know, a teacher, a prophet. No, the Bible is clear. He is, Jesus is the fullness of the Godhead bodily. The name above every name is the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Every other spirit, every other entity is demonic. He made us human beings in his image. And he didn't become a part of the Galactic Federation. He didn't go and die on the cross for the googly moos on some planet somewhere. He didn't become a googly moo. He became a human being. You hear me? God Almighty put himself inside of a woman and was born a human being, fully God, fully man, so that he could live a sinless life and die on a cross for our sins. No other did that for you. And there's no other beings and no other galaxies and no other civilizations far, far away. These are all lies. Again, all of it's built to make us think that we're somehow not special, that we're not the apple of God's eye. Redemption. Literally, I have Catholic priests saying, I've got the quotes from them, saying that maybe these other beings from other planets, maybe they don't need redemption. They're so holy and pure and righteous. Can you believe that nonsense? No, it's just us worthless worms Jesus had to come and die for. Folks, there is one God, one creator. Everything else is part of the creation. We don't have to lower ourselves to worship part of the creation. You hear me? See, even them bowing to these things, oh, these are our saviors, these are our gods, this is our hope. They're still bowing to created things. And we serve the creator of all things. Amen? And they know it too. They know it. I'd like to go with Dr. Greer out to one of his little CE5 events. I'd mess it all up for them. They would get mad and make me leave. Let's pray. Father, thank you for this day. Thank you, Lord God, that you have given us the truth. Not just, Lord, in your word. We have the truth of your word in the Bible. But then you bring your Holy Spirit and you speak and you lead us and guide us into all truth. I thank you, Lord, that we can walk in this world and not be deceived by Satan, by the demons, by the fallen angels, even by the people who are deceived. I thank you, Lord, that we can walk free from that deception and walk with you in a real relationship. And Lord, I ask you to touch your people, those here today, those watching and listening. Holy Spirit, move and work in their lives and set many captives free from this deception, this UFO alien deception, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Folks are going to get set free. The truth sets people free. Amen. Jesus said, you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free. So that's why I have to preach on these things. Because you say, well, Pastor, I don't need to hear about all this stuff. Maybe you don't, but somebody does. Amen. All right. Y'all know the drill. Hug some necks before you leave.